What we are going to talk today is about geospatial user feedback, and I try to do a table of content a little bit more direct and original here. We will say that feedback is not only for books. We will say that feedback, at least geospatial feedback, has been standardized. We will present modules of the solution we are doing here in XGEOS, and assuming that you want it, we will tell you how to do that, and eventually we will reflect on our future and the future of the feedback. So feedback is everywhere, and we are bombarded now constantly by companies to provide our opinions, sometimes to just for the companies to make us believe that we are important from them. Some other times, probably honestly. And here we are seeing a girl in an airport saying that her travel experience was good, and we are talking about that. Actually, we know that mechanism from Amazon and other companies that started many years ago using that. So to help people to find exactly the type of thing they are looking for, feedback from other users can be useful and complementary to the data producer's description. In this case, we are looking at a book description, so that's the producer's description. Just the pages, the title, the abstract, the ISBN, whatever. But this is complemented by other information. And this information, we call it feedback. It starts by stars, some of those yellow symbols, the more the better. It can have also summaries of how those stars has been evolving in the last period. It has a short description of our review, who has been the reviewer, a long text, and things that could be even more sophisticated, like, for instance, feedback about feedback. So in this case, is asking us if the reviewer was good and helpful. So this is actually feedback about feedback. So if we analyze this, it is more complex than it might look in the surface and has a lot more possibilities. How to make feedback geospatial? So, well, it is, of course, by adding two things. We are going to use geospatial information. So for that reason, the feedback is geospatial per se, but also we are going to see things in places in the space. So imagine a user A that is looking at a particular region of a data set, and it sees something wrong there, something that doesn't belong there. So in this case, he wants to report about this particular thing. So in the geospatial tool, he presses a button, the feedback mechanism starts. He enters the system, and he populates a report. This particular area, this red bubble that I have digitized here, contains a rara avis. Later, a user B that will visit the same data set and the same region will retrieve the feedback of that data set if it's affected by the same extent, and will be informed about that. But it is more than stars and comments, as I say, because we can do that in a very communicative way, so we are able to communicate experiences and even knowledge in terms of usage reports, in terms of quality assessments of the data we have used, in terms of the significant event detection that I was talking about in the example, and in terms of even additional processing that was needed to do for using the data. And yes, it is actually in a standard. And I say that this was originated in a project that we lead that was called GeoViqua. Then There was another project led by the University of Reading that was called Charmy that did some annotation work that more or less, well, had some connections with the other thing. So we founded a group in the OGC, the Open Geospatial Consortium, and in 2016 we managed to produce a couple of standards that were approved by the community and now represent part of what is so-called the OGC baseline. This is a conceptual model and an encoding for the feedback. Well, this standard contains some boxes describing the different elements and the different attributes of these. That is definitely too much detail to explain that to you, but it is connected with ratings, comments, usage reports, significant events, additional quality reports, citations of publications, and all this stuff that I keep mentioning. What we are doing here in NextGeos is to implement that in practice. So what we have is a triangle between the user, the data, and the feedback storage. At the top of the image, you see some data that we are using and we eventually want to evaluate and report about. Then we have a smart user that is actually taking a look at this and evaluating this. And in another extreme of the triangle, we see the feedback storage. So some place in the internet, we will have one or many services, servers that are going to store the user feedback. Okay, so the smart user was actually a girl, as you see here, and she is reporting. By reporting, that means that she is producing some information, some comments, some stars, some quality assessment, whatever, and it's sending this into the feedback server. The objective is to multiply the number of contributors in a way that acknowledged share is produced, and that information together constitutes something that is worthwhile to query. So when the user comes back and wants to explore what is out there to try and found compatible information, he can browse in an informal way and he can pick and choose, and eventually she gains knowledge about the information it's finding and using. In practice, that means that you need to connect the feedback with the data set. And to do that, you need an identifier. Datasets will be identified by a unique identifier. This was not common practice 20 years ago, but it's becoming common practice, that so this shouldn't be a barrier these days. And then we need a data input portal that will authenticate the user, and once the user is authenticated, a form will emerge, and she will type the necessary information that will travel to the server thanks to an API, and will be stored in this case in the Nimbus system. That is one possible implementation of the server side of this thing. For visualizing, the client application will run the application program interface again. It will ask for, give me feedback about this particular data set with this ID, and the Nimbus system will respond with the textual information that is seen as part of the result. Here in the left-hand side of the screen. Okay, how much time do you have? Because there are several ways of implementing this. So the first approach is you take the standards. Those are long documents written digitally, of course, but you can print it if you want to be more scary. And actually, the API that we develop in Next.js to communicate clients and services, and implement that by yourself. You will need weeks of intense work with databases, server-side code, JavaScript, single sign-on, HTML, CSS, you name it. But we don't want that you necessarily have to do that. You can do that, of course, if you enjoy doing that. But in practice, it could be good that you are able to recycle some things that Next.js has produced for you. So you could use the Nimbus for data input and implement a personalized presentation of the existing feedback just because you are very, very careful with your corporation imagery and you want the same colors, the same fonts, the same sizes, everything resembles. Then you will need to spend several hours of work interpreting some XML and transforming that into HTML. It's not so hard, but it will be difficult and will require some expertise. Or you could use the widget for presentation and input. You can personalize the widget a little bit, but it's a black box that you use. And if you are satisfied with what it does, in less than an hour, you will be able to have your spatial user feedback in place. So let's assume that you are convinced, and I convince you. So let's assume that you want it. So how to do that? So the fast, probably you want only the fast solution. And if you want the others, then we can agree with Bente to have a 3-week webinar in a single piece just to explain you the first approach, but that will be too much. Where to start? We have a GitHub repository with some information and some documentation and also some examples. So you can easily learn from that. There is the URL that I will not try and read, but it's not so remote. And Bente will tell you later that the presentation will be available, that's for sure. So the presentation will be available for you to copy that URL and the rest of the information if needed. It's a very simple process that requires 4 steps. Step number 0 is, do you need the resource unique identifier? I already say that. You need a code that identifies your dataset in a repository, and then you need what we call a code space that generally is another code that identifies the repository by itself. If you don't have any code space, you could use the URL of the web service, for instance, as code space. That will work. Is that easy to do? Well, catalogs has identifiers. So, well, for instance, we can go to the Next.js public release of the Next.js hub and take a look at the catalog. Let's do that. So here you see one Sentinel image that I have detected with a quick search, and immediately by clicking into the description, you get some metadata, and in particular, something that most users will find terrified, but in this case, is exactly what we are looking for, a sequence of characters that actually identifies this object uniquely into the 1 million objects that are in the catalog these days. Okay, so let's assume that we have the identifier. Then we are ready to build something that will allow you to provide feedback about this data set in particular by using the identifier handler. So first step will be to modify your system a little bit. So I'm now assuming that you have some kind of a catalog or portal or something in the internet that is offering data. And you want the users to see the feedback about this data and provide feedback about this data. So you have an HTML page someplace. It will be easy for you in these premises that you add a JavaScript library. That's the second line here. And some additional styles that is the first line here. So very simple. You take those lines, you put it in your document. That's it. Then you need to define a division. That's a region in your HTML page where the user feedback will, and the button asking for new feedback will be presented. This area is going to be used by the widget, and at the beginning it will be empty, and when you ask for the feedback, it will be automatically redimensioned if the position is relative, as it is explained here. The step number three will be to call one of the functions that are available in the JavaScript function library that you just imported in the step number one. And the function is called geospatial user feedback show feedback in HTML division. So it's a very straightforward name for the thing. The idea is to execute that at the end of the page or when the user wants to see the feedback. Let's assume that we want the user to control that. So we will place a button or a link, in this case it's a link, where when the user clicks on that stuff, the function will be executed. And this function has some parameters, and this is a little bit complex, but one of the parameters is this scary long sequence of numbers and characters that is the identifier of the resource. And also you see the reference to the catalog, so the catalog URL that acts as a code space. The rest of the parameters are relatively more simple to understand. There is the name of the division that you also have to provide, and then the function knows where to place the geospatial user feedback. There is a prefix of other divisions that are going to be created in the widget. There is the name of the resource. You can put resource or dataset or map or whatever, and a title that satisfies you that is going to be used for creating the citation of this resource in the Nimbus system. And the last parameter is a reference to a language. For the moment, the widget is available in three languages, starting by the end in English, in Spanish, and even in Catalan. So in practice, this is going to look like this. In the left-hand side, you see in gray the aspect of the original HTML page, and in green, you see the modified page, and this was prepared by Allies. And if we scroll down, you see that the green hand side presents the different feedback pieces. In this case, you only see two of them, and also presents the add user feedback button for you to press that and input new stuff into the feedback system. If we press that, you will see this. The Nimbus system is actually part of the NextGeos Federation, so it shares the same single sign-on. That means the same user and password combination. So if you are already NextGeos user, you with your single user name, you will be able also to present or encode feedback into our module. And when you enter, you see this screen where you are able to populate the different fields, and you also see at the top of the blue area that in this particular example, feedback about the Corine 2012 is going to be input. So do you want to review the three steps again? So very simple, and this is an example that I'm repeating from a training session, user feedback training session, and you can see in the right-hand side, if you turn your head, the URL. So in this example, there was a HTML page that was describing the Corine, and you simply add step number one, the libraries. State number two, you create the division, and state number three, you actually call the function that is going to populate the division with the existing feedback plus the button to add new feedback. So very simple, just three steps, always the same. It's straightforward for you, and you get immediately the results that you have seen before in the green area of the previous page. All right, so a little bit of future, just for you to understand that this is not just pure developing stuff for the sake of doing that. It is also a research activity where we are trying to see beyond. So in another project, we are developing a map browser with the capability to create dynamic layers. The project is called EcoPotential. We are also reusing the same thing and extending this for citizen science in ground truth. The idea is the following. The user can take two bands of a Sentinel image and generate an NDVI or whatever or in this index that he wants to do. Or he wants to he can create whatever RGB combination he wants based on three bands. Or the user can combine several layers into a layer arithmetic engine that will do pixel by pixel calculation and generate a virtual layer in the end. Those dynamic layers cannot be shared at this moment because it's something that the user is doing on the fly, and it will disappear when the browser is closed. Except if we were able to store the dynamic layers in the geospatial user feedback system as usage reports of the original sources. So by doing that, we will send to the Nimbus information about a new data set that is possible to be done using the original sources. By doing that, we will have a user report. The user's report has an ID. So now we have an ID of that represents the user's report that is actually the dynamic layer two. So we are able to provide feedback about that again. So feedback including the lineage of the data set, data quality, or whatever. So this is going to be a way to not just create feedback about virtual layers, but to share the virtual layers dynamically with other users, accompanied by the results and the experience of creating those dynamic layers. So this is something that we have in mind, and we are considering how we could extend the geospatial user feedback to allow that to be done. So this is all, now again, we ask you for questions or, of course, for your feedback.
And we are back. So that was a short demonstration of how it works on the NextGeos Data Hub. And Joan, I think that everybody who have a portal can do the same in some implementation on their own, right?
Yeah, they can do the same. They can do it if they are part of NextGeos. And our community portals will definitely do that to give a more interactive experience with the users. But actually, everybody could do it. And we have experimented that in many places, like a duplicate of the Inspire portal. And as I commented before, we are doing that in the Eco Potential project. So yeah, if you have another catalog, you can do it by yourself, and the Geospatial User Feedback Nimbus system will store the feedback for you, so you will not require any cloud space to pay anything or whatever.
Okay, so the Nimbus is sort of the common denominator for those who are implementing this.
Yeah, that is correct. For the moment, we are hosting the back in our cloud, in our private cloud. It is also possible to deploy on other instances of the Nimbus system in other places, but there has not been any customer that have specifically asked that before. If they ask, that it's a possibility.
Okay, so if you want to use the NextGeos platform, this user feedback service will be an integral part of the services that you can choose from.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely.
The Geospatial User Feedback has been developed as an independent module, but it's completely integrated into the NextGeos Federation.
Right. So we have several pilots with their own portals for their user communities. And some of these user communities, they are using the same data sets for different purposes, but they are using the same data set. Is there any way that we can extract the user feedback from different portals?
I'm assuming that they are going to use the NextGeos Hub as a central catalog. So even if a data set is presented in different community portals, it will share the same identifier. So the feedback that is provided from one community portal will automatically transverse to the other portal and be part of the whole collection of feedbacks that are stored in a generic place and shared everywhere.
Yeah, so this means that not only does a user community that has implemented the user feedback service on their portal benefit from the user feedback from their users, but they also, by being on NextGeos, will benefit from getting feedback from other types of use that they might, you know, find interesting and useful for new use for their users, right? So that's one of the advantages of being on the NextGeos platform.
It is.
Yeah. So I don't see that people are asking any questions. You've been very, very shy today. But Joan, these presentations that you gave today will be made available on NextGeos, right? We will get the PDFs from you. And of course, the recording will also be made available for even for those who didn't register, but for you that registered, you will get this replay in your inbox by, I think, tonight, so you can see it again. Because I think that the instructions that you gave, it was a short version of the training in Geneva where you introduced this first, and I think the feedback we got from the NextGeos folks there was that this was really useful. So I think this will help you if you want to integrate the user feedback service on your portal. and you can return to the presentation. And of course, you have, I believe you have all the documentation that they can dive deeper into, Joan, if they need to.
Yeah, they can go to the GitHub. That is, we are not using only as a code repository, but also as a documentation center.
Okay. Right. So everything is there. And we will write about this on our on next year's blog. And if you have questions there that we didn't, you know, that we don't capture elsewhere, you can, we will pick it up there. Then I think I will conclude, unless you have, do you have anything else to that you want to add, Joan, that we, that you forgot to say, or you want people to underline what something?
Well, the only thing that comes to my mind is that we have even simplified the integration a little bit more than what we present in Geneva. So the number of lines of code that you need to include has decreased in 30%. So it's even more easy to do that. So you have no excuse anymore.
Saving time, huh? Saving time, yes. But if I'm sure that we will be able to run another webinar later, but the next webinar on this subject, but the next webinar will be on the 26th of April. So don't forget about that. You will, the next GEOS webinar series is running at least one webinar per month. And the next one is benefit for users. So again, focusing on the users in various applications areas. So for scientific communities, for the public administration, and for commercial purposes. So we will highlight, we will focus a little bit how this is beneficial for these different user groups. That's the next webinar coming up in April. But it's the 26th of April. But before that, if you are going to EGU, and you are, Joan, I know you will make efforts,
yes,
to.
I'm one of the 10,000 people that goes to the EGU.
Yes, yes. Well, 16,000 also. Now 16, I heard. Yeah, it's crazy. Yes, so that's a large gathering for the scientific community, and Joan will be there, and I will be there, and we will have the next GEOS Splinter meeting on the 10th of April. So you are all welcome to join us there, and you will be able to have a repeat, a replay, a live replay in this case, and the possibility to talk to Joan directly. In live, in situ, what do you call it? And yes, and then I also want to remind you that we are having yet another possibility to meet the next GEOS folks, and that will be at our summit, which is going to be in Lisbon on the 1st and the 2nd of July, just before the EuroGEOS workshop. So we assume there will be a whole lot of Earth observation people going there, and you will be able to meet us and learn more about the next GEOS platform and how we are using it. There is always room for more people using next GEOS. We have a whole set of services. Now you heard today about the user feedback service, which is a platform service that is offered to all web pilots on next GEOS. But we also have the possibility for you to catalog your data if you are having data from other EU projects, for instance. It's possible to catalog that on our data hub. It's also possible to showcase your applications and services on our data hub. And you see that we have this user feedback mechanism already integrated there. So there is several advantages of doing just that, in addition to have your external pilot if you're not one of the internal pilots here. So with that, I think I will say goodbye. Thank you so much, Joan, for being such a good sport and presenting the whole package for us.
My pleasure.
And until the next time.
Yep.
Bye-bye.
Cheers.